All right. Well, I think we are all very excited. It's been a full few days here, but for our last keynote speaker, I am pleased and so lucky to introduce Sandra McElway and her son, Sean McElway. And Sandra's going to come up first. And I asked if she wanted me to read her whole bio and introduction, and she said, well, I'm not going to have enough time to talk then. So I'm going to keep it short and sweet. Sandra and Sean, you probably know them as the stars of the A&E Emmy Award-winning show Born This Way. Sandra is also the author of 3 books and Sean's mother, and we are so happy to have them here today. So help me welcome Sandra McElway.
When Sean was only 3 months old, they hosted a speaker who introduced us to this new option in school called inclusive education. And the speaker introduced us to the least restrictive environment and explained that the term meant least restrictive is the general education setting. And I learned that anyone could be included in school according to the law. I learned that IDEA was an amendment to the 1973 Education for All Children's Act, and I thought to myself, oh, 5 years from now, it's going to all be in place by the time Sean's in kindergarten, so that's great. Well, with the help of Sean's therapist, he walked just before he turned 2, and as Sean turned 3, we were temporarily transferred to Washington State. It was a very boring year for me. Sean was in school several hours a day, and I didn't have any friends there, and there was this new thing called the internet that was just starting up. And before I would get in the shower in the morning, I would start the dial-up to download my emails. And we were on this parent email list of parents and children with Down syndrome that was something that had existed way before Facebook. And all these parents on this email list were talking about inclusion and the struggles they were having. And I thought, okay, this is the time I have to learn about inclusion in the law and how to advocate for Sean when we get back to California to be in general education kindergarten. So back in California, still in preschool, Sean attended both special education preschool classes in the district and received his therapies there, and he attended 2 afternoons a week in a regular education preschool. Now the law has since changed and students should be included in regular education preschool in the school district as well. But that isn't happening anywhere yet either. Well, my original assumption that inclusion would be the norm 5 years after I learned about it was so wrong. It was a very foreign concept in our school district. And we decided, because Sean has a very late birthday in October, that we were gonna have him repeat kindergarten. So he went to special education kindergarten, and then the next year he was going to repeat kindergarten in our neighborhood school in a fully inclusive setting. Well, he had the same teacher for preschool, and she moved up and taught kindergarten when he moved up. So he had had her for 3 years. I had volunteered in her class quite a bit, so we had a really good relationship. And as Sean's transition IEP was coming up, I told her my expectation for him to have a classroom assistant to help facilitate his inclusion in regular education. Well, a week ahead of the IEP, she told me that the director of special education told her, you cannot put an aide on his IEP. If he can't do the same work as the regular education students, without an aide, he can't be fully included. So I wrote a letter to the director of special education, saying that the director of special education must be present at the IEP, and if she was unable to make the currently scheduled date, then the meeting needed to be rescheduled. I had been on the community advisory committee in the school district, so she knew who I was, and she knew I wasn't messing around. And I knew if she was present, it would make all the difference, because she was the one who had the authority to make the decisions. Well, Sean had some behaviors. He wasn't a perfectly compliant child, and one of his biggest ones, he did not want to go back into class after recess. That was one of his biggest challenges. And when he was in special education, kindergarten and preschool, and I attended the special education community advisory committee meetings, not only did I meet the director of special ed, I also met other parents who wanted their children fully included within the school district. And there were five of us, and each of our kids were in a different elementary school. So we collaborated, or conspired, depends on what you want to call it, to do a lot of things to make a lot of change in our school district. Well, back to the IEP meeting. The director of special education did attend the IEP meeting, and when the topic of the classroom aide came up, she just wrote it on the IEP. There was no discussion, there was no conversation about it, she just wrote it in. We didn't even discuss it. Sean's special education teacher was sitting on the other side of the director of special ed, so when the director of special ed was looking at me, she couldn't see the special education teacher. And she, when she wrote it in without saying anything, she went, and I don't even read lips, and excuse me for the profanity if you can, but she was feeling all six wheels of bus rolling over her, because there would have been a huge argument between us if the director of special ed wasn't there to actually write that in. So the key I learned at that point was the people who hold the authority have to be present at the IEP in order to get what you actually need. So as the IEP was winding down, the school psychologist, who in my book I call Mrs. Sunshine, she felt compelled to try to talk me out of this foreign idea of inclusion. She said, are you sure this is what you want to do? Do you really think he's going to learn as much in a regular education class? What if he doesn't come in from recess? And what do you think the other students would accept him? Well, I had done my homework, and thankfully I had all the answers. So I said, well, this is definitely what I want. Sean will learn more in regular ed than he will in special ed simply because he'll be exposed to more. And there's all kinds of evidence-based studies showing that. And there's also evidence-based studies showing the benefits for the regular education students as well. If he refuses to come in for recess, well, that's why we have an aide. She can deal with him so the teacher isn't taken away from the other students. And the other students, they will see Sean as a classmate. Remember this conversation for a little later in my presentation. So, the research I'd done at the time had shown that the teacher was the key to successful inclusion. And teachers who had positive perceptions of students with disabilities being included in their class had fewer behavior problems with the students, and the students were more socially included with their peers. So I created a video of Sean, including and interviewing his special education teacher. We were both very honest about his challenges, his abilities, and the many supports and accommodations he would need to be successful in general education. And I took that video to our neighborhood elementary school and asked the principal to please have all the kindergarten teachers view the video and ask one to volunteer to be Sean's teacher. Well, the day after I took that video of Sean to the principal, an amazing teacher called me at home, and she told me she believed all students should be educated together, and she would be honored to have Sean in her class. Well, I was thrilled beyond words. Sean loved going to school, and he was truly included and participated in everything that the class did. Sean is deaf in his right ear, so the school installed an FM system in his class with four speakers placed around the room, and the teacher had a wireless microphone. Sean could hear her no matter where he was, where she was in relation to him in the room, and she used the microphone during her programs, too. The kids loved speaking in the microphone. It was very successful, except for the few times she went to the bathroom and forgot to take it off. So Sean loved performing in his kindergarten class, and with his classroom aide and the other 19 students, they were also all his teachers. First grade was amazing. That teacher also had a daughter with Down syndrome who was a few years older than Sean. And she worked so hard late at night modifying materials for Sean. And she enlisted the other students in the class to help teach Sean. And every day when I went to drop him off at class, they were jumping up and down, begging, "Can I be Sean's reading buddy today? Can I be Sean's math buddy today?" It was really exciting. Well, when you teach, you truly reinforce what you know. And the students that helped Sean in first grade were later identified as gifted and talented. And at the time, I always wondered, were they born gifted and talented? Or it was helping Sean what actually gave them such a solid base of learning that it catapulted them ahead. Later, there was a study that came out that showed that it's definitely the case, that when students teach peers, they do better at reading and math. Something else happened in first grade. Mrs. Sunshine, the school psychologist, was transferred to Sean's school. Well, when Sean was in kindergarten, we read a book about a child with Down syndrome to the class, but the kids really didn't generalize the information to Sean. So when we asked them, "Does anybody here know anyone with Down syndrome?" they all looked around. No. So because Sean's first grade teacher was so brilliant, she helped me write a book about Sean, and we just printed it on computer paper, and she read it to the class. And it was about Sean specifically, his challenges, why his speech was difficult to understand. And he was an immediate celebrity. He had a book written about him, even though it was just on computer paper stapled on the side. But she also sent the book home to the parents, so the parents could read it to the children one more time. And in the back, we included a fact sheet on inclusion and a fact sheet on Down syndrome, so the parents got to learn too. We never had one of those parents ever say they didn't want their child in Sean's class. It was really a fantastic tool. Then, in first grade, Sean learned to read and add, but most of all, he made friends. We had 40 kids at his birthday party. Wow. And I was making goodie bags for 2 weeks before. So, and of course, as Sean made friends, we made friends too. I mean, we all lived in the same neighborhood area. That's one of the big benefits of inclusion in your neighborhood school. And since I've been involved in the community advisory committee and had my four friends that were at other schools, we emailed each other all the time. We had dinner for at least once a month, and we compared notes. And by second grade, we realized that it was too much to ask the general education teachers to modify the curriculum for our kids. So we conspired together to enlist our district's inclusion specialists to modify materials from third grade on. And with all five of us adding that requirement to our IEPs, we succeeded in getting the district to hire someone to modify curriculum. Well, today's teachers are being taught techniques in universal design and how to teach diverse learners in one classroom. So the modifications are done naturally in the school day. And other schools where the teachers haven't learned universal design yet, they're using the resource teachers and special educators to collaborate and modify curriculum. Well, Sean's articulation was extremely delayed. Sean had great receptive language. He understood everything everyone said, but it was very difficult to understand him. He had oral motor apraxia, verbal apraxia, and a phonological processing disorder, and a high narrow palate, and it was just very difficult to understand him. We even had to make a photo list for Santa so he could understand Sean's request. But in third grade, the articulation issues got better. Sean got a palate expander and braces. And when third grade started, we had a new principal. And another thing happened. Mrs. Sunshine came to me at the beginning of school, and she apologized for trying to talk me out of inclusion when Sean was transitioning. Her observations were that, indeed, Sean was learning more than he would have in a special education class, and she was amazed at his classmates' acceptance of him. And she told me that third grade was the only grade she had that didn't have one bully in the whole grade. She was sold on inclusion based on Sean pioneering it in the school. Well, Sean was writing and reading and doing multiplication in third grade. And between third grade and fourth grade, the teacher, the principal, the school psychologist, and the inclusion specialist from the district all went with me to an inclusion conference, education conference. And in fourth grade, the elementary school transformed to an inclusive school. The principal met with each of the students in the segregated special day classes and with their parents in an IEP meeting and offered them to stay at the class at the school in a general education class with all the supports they would need, or they could move from the special education classes to a neighboring school. 18 students were fully included after that meeting, but that's in that elementary school. Well, Sean was in choir, but he couldn't carry a tune. He was always included in everything. Even when he didn't have the energy to stand up for the whole performance, nobody cared. It took him 18 minutes to run and walk the mile. And as he rounded the last lap, his classmates joined him so he wouldn't be running alone. Sean was embraced. Nobody ever dreamed of bullying him. If they had, they would have had the rest of the grade to deal with. Well, Sean did everything in the fourth grade. He performed in the fourth grade play on California Street. He was a Cub Scout. His class went on an overnight field trip to Sacramento, which is the capital of California. And they had to fly there. And they spent the night in a hotel. Well, I chaperoned, but I was in my own room, and he was in his own room with three other boys. It was very, very much an independent situation. And he also learned to play the violin. He soloed in a concert playing Hot Cross Buns, which I think was really the only song he learned. and in the spring, he started walking to school with the kids in the neighborhood. Well, fifth grade was a banner year. Sean loved math, and he learned to add fractions, or as he called them, factions. He continued in the choir and had his first sleepover at our house. And he had a few girlfriends. Aww. Ladies man's been around for a long time. in sixth grade, Sean began having some anxiety. The second day of sixth grade, they actually introduced new band instruments to his class. And he came home and looked at me and said, "Trumpet." And I pretended like I couldn't understand what he was saying. He could barely blow bubbles. I was certain he couldn't make a sound come out of a trumpet. Well, he showed me. The next day, he came home from school with a picture book from the library. And he opened the book, pointed to the picture of the trumpet, and said, "Trumpet, I play." Okay, well, I guess I had to listen to him. He made himself understood. And I never told Sean no. I allowed him to naturally fail out of things. So I called the instrument rental store, and I said, "Do you have a trumpet, teacher?" And they said, "Yes, we do." And I said, "Can you have him call me?" So this wonderful man said he would work for Sean for 30 minutes for free. I'm just the nicest guy. So Sean tried, and he because of his oral motor apraxia, you know, you could say, pucker your lips, and he'd open his mouth. You know, he couldn't, the brain, the connection, he just can't make his lips do what you're telling him to do. And this teacher worked with him. Finally, 20 minutes in, Sean made a tiny squeak come out of the trumpet. So we rented the trumpet and hired the trumpet teacher for four lessons, and Sean played in the band. So he was having this anxiety. We couldn't figure figure out what it was. They can't even walk out of class for no apparent reason. The teacher said he would just start crying. And you know, you'd ask him why. He just couldn't say why. Well, we have a science camp that our school goes to in sixth grade, and it's held in a place on a local mountain campground called Big Bear. And the amazing principal figured out what was causing the anxiety. She used to ask Sean, "Are you nervous about science camp?" He said, "Yes! Finally, somebody figured it out." And she said, "Well, what are you nervous about?" And he said, "Big Bears." Because if it's being held in a place called Big Bear, there's going to be big bears there, right? Well, we had a desert tortoise at the time who hibernated, so Sean knew what hibernation was. And we explained that there would be no bears. They were all, you know, would all be sleeping, and it would be fine. But kudos to her for realizing his behavior was a form of communication, and that because he was truly worried, he just couldn't verbalize what he was worried about. And camp was great. He had a blast. Well, at sixth grade promotion, as the principal began to describe the student who would receive the President's Award for overcoming adversity, we were extremely thrilled that Sean received that honor. The attitude of all the school staff was that they did whatever it would take to help Sean be successful, and the result was transforming for the whole school. Well, fast forward 4 years, that school was where we voted, when that was our voting place. So I was in the school voting, and I ran into Mrs. Sunshine. And she said, "Come to my office, I have to tell you the story." So she told me that since Sean left the school, that they had moved preschool special day classes to the campus. And there was a little girl that was transitioning from preschool to kindergarten who had Down syndrome and lived in the neighborhood. And at the IEP meeting, she says, "I want to see every special ed kindergarten class in the school district so I can decide which one is the best for my daughter." And Mrs. Sunshine and the principal said to her, "We will make sure you get a tour of every special ed kindergarten class in the district, but we want you to know this is your neighborhood school and your daughter is welcome to come to school here." And she goes, "Well, there's no special ed kindergarten here." And they said, "No, we have here a fully included school, and your daughter will be in a regular education class with her typically developing peers." And she said, "Well, she can't do the same work as them." He said, "That's okay. We modify all the curriculum and make accommodations based on the student's needs and our inclusive classes." She goes, "Well, what if she doesn't come in off the playground?" Apparently she had the same problem Sean did. And they said, "That's okay. All of our aides, all of our classroom assistants have been trained in behavior management techniques." And she said, "Well, what about the other kids? What's gonna, you know, are they, how do they feel about kids with Down syndrome?" And she said, "Well, actually, the kids with Down syndrome are the most popular students on our campus." I was so proud, because that is the way it's supposed to be, and that is how true change truly happens. And the fact that Sean started that is something that we will always be thrilled about. And now Sean is going to come and tell you about what he's been doing since then.